you still choose Jesus? Will you still choose Jesus? And it's a trip because I wrote this message and God dropped it in my heart and I'm writing it and stuff. And it's just heavy because in your life as it, and even BC, you know what BC is? Before Christ. You know what I mean? Before Christ, you know what I mean? We lived our lives and we made choices in our lives. We made choices with when we were kids, you know what I mean? And some of us, you know what I mean? We didn't know what we were doing when we chose somebody to be with, you know what I mean? And then you end up having children or choices to, you know what I mean? Whatever it is, you know what I mean? Jobs, choices to drop out of school, choices to, you know what I mean? Whatever it is, to do crime and violence and maybe end up in prison. You know what I mean? And different things like that. In our lives, we've made some choices. And a lot, and with BC, you know what I mean? That we made it without Christ. And we made some bad choices. And my daughter was talking about like divorce and stuff. And some of you got yourself in situations that you made a choice to be with somebody or to choose somebody, and it wasn't the right choice.
Yeah, uh-huh.
And you ended up, and you made a choice to walk away from that. You know what I mean? Which may have been a good thing or may not have been a good thing.
Right.
You know what I mean? But it was your choice. And in life, you have so many choices. But the choices that we make, even BC, right? Before
yeah.
Christ?
Yeah.
Or AD, you know what I mean? After we die with Him.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's the choice to continue serving God. You know, you think, for example, I made a decision November 23rd, 1985 to serve the Lord. You know what I mean? But I've had so many choices and so many opportunities throughout the 30 years that I've been saved to choose not to serve Him anymore.
Yeah.
And there's been times I've been so hurt in my heart, man. Hurt in my heart, driving the city, weeping and crying and saying, God, it's not fair. It's not fair what we go through. It's not fair that, you know what I mean, people want to serve God when they want to serve God. And then when they don't. But they don't realize they're hurting us.
Yeah. Right.
You think it's just between you and the Lord and you can do whatever, but you don't realize there's people involved in your lives. There's people that have sacrificed very much for you to be here this morning. But see, you don't see that. You with me? I didn't realize my mother had sacrificed so much as a kid just to give me a good life. You know what I mean? I was making choices that were hurting her. But I wasn't thinking of that. You know what I mean? And sometimes we have made choices and we've done stuff to hurt our pastors. But it wasn't maybe intentional. We just didn't know what we were doing. But we need to know what we're doing. We need to grow in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We need to learn to grow in the Word of God and see, you know what I mean? Hey, listen, my life is not my own no more. So what I'm trying to teach my guys is your life is not your own, dude. Your life is not your own. You don't just choose when you want to do or when you want to serve or when you want to give. Or it's not your own anymore.
Right.
That's what I'm trying to teach them. You with me?
Amen.
And it's like we all have to learn that. Every single one of you ladies have to learn that.
Amen.
Your life as a Christian is no longer your own. You made a choice to jump on the cross.
Amen.
And so it's no longer you that live, but Christ that lives in you. And the life you now live, you don't live by your own faith. You don't live by your own ideas and your own knowledge and your own wisdom. You live by the faith of the Son of God who gave Himself for you. You with me? And so it's like our lives are not our own. You know what I mean? We did our own thing. We made our own choices. And somehow in your life, you made a choice to where, you know what I mean, choices to brought you to the crossroads in your life that said, hey, I need God. I can't do it by myself no more. You with me? Understand that, Christian. This morning, you can't do it by yourself. I know you think you're wise. I know you think you're smart. I know you think you're knowledgeable. But why are you here this morning? You're here this morning because you're not all those things. And maybe, you know what I mean? He said, when God saved you, were we scholars and were we all? No, we were all jacked up. We might have been hustlers. You might have been slanging and doing this and had a lot of things. But you were on your way to hell. And God intervened in your life and He saved you just the way you were. Even if you were, you know, many people think, well, I want to go to school and learn so much and become a doctor and a master's degree and all this other stuff. But, you know what I mean? All that can't save you.
That's right.
All that can't make you. He said the Greeks, you know what I mean? They want science. They want to grow. They want to question. They want all this stuff, you know what I mean? Because they're so smart. But he said the wisdom of man is nothing compared to the wisdom of God. It's foolishness to God.
Right.
You with me? And we're always, you know what I mean? And the choices that we make, and that's what I want to talk to you about, the choices we make in life, you know what I mean? They brought us to where we are today. And even as a Christian, you got to understand, my daughter's talking about us serving the Lord, as even just as pastors for 20 years. And I'm telling you, in our early years and stuff like that, we made some decisions. We made financial decisions that hurt my family. I did. To buy a car that's, you know, so many hundreds a month that is going to affect our finances every month.
Yeah.
You with me? And I was always at the car lots, man. I love to go shopping for cars. You know, and I'd sit there and haggle and finagle. Well, how much do you have, Mr. Diaz, to put down? And I'm like, well, let me think, you know. I ain't got nothing, man. Well, could we do it with no down payment and all this stuff, you know what I mean? And then getting involved in something that, you know what I mean, it wasn't necessarily such a evil thing to do, you know what I mean, but it was getting me in financial trouble. And then every month, you with me? Then it affected not only my personal finances, but my giving to the church. And some of you don't understand that. You with me? You think it's all about your personal finance, and if you give a few bucks, then they ought to be thankful. And it doesn't. It has to do with your faith in Jesus Christ. It has to do with your obedience to give to the Lord. You don't have to give, you get to give. You with me? I've been talking. Some of you ought to come to prayer on Monday and Friday nights. I don't know why you don't come. Maybe you feel like you're too busy to come, but your family needs to get saved. You got loved ones out there that need to get saved. Your church, you want it to grow, but you got to come and pray if you're going to. You with me? You with me? Prayer is important. I don't just do it for because I ain't got nothing else to do and I want to give you just one more thing to add to your bag. I'm trying to teach you something, that prayer changes things. And it's because we've been praying Mondays and Fridays for the last 20 years that some of you are even here this morning. Had we not done that, who knows where you would have been. And many of you today, you're here because we've prayed. You're here because we took a whole year, you know what I mean? And every single night we came here for at least an hour. You know what I mean? Not this church. I think we were in Dog Patch when we did it. Every single night for a whole year, we didn't miss. We came and we laid before God and we asked God to touch. We asked God to move. We asked God to save. And some of you, I've been praying for years. You might have been here now, but I've been praying years for you. And it's that kind of dedication and that kind of understanding that, gee, maybe I need to go to prayer. It's not something you have to do. It's like, man, pastor makes it an opportunity for us so that I can go pray. You know what I mean? Because you need to learn to pray. I know you think you know how. That's the problem, is that you think you know what you're doing. And you got to become teachable and pliable. Yeah. You know what I mean? And who you can say all day you listen to God.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
But if you don't listen to, if he says you say you believe in God, but I mean, or you love God but hate your brother, he says, how do you love God? You can't even see God.
Right.
You need to love those who are right in front of you and love them as if they were God to your life.
Amen.
You with me? And say, you know what, we want to be a part, we want to grow, we want to do that, we want to see our families saved. But it's a choice.
Amen.
It's a choice. Everything in life is a choice. Amen?
Amen.
Joshua 24:15, I said this last week, I think. But if you refuse to serve the Lord, he said, and I put this in parentheses, then choose today who you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. He told him in there, he said, you could choose the gods of your fathers. You know what your daddies did.
Yeah.
And some of your daddies were nice religious men. who went to St. Leander's every, you know, Easter and Christmas, put a tie on and went and went through the rolls. You know what I mean? Holy Mary, Mother God, you know, come to the front to get your communion. And they knew everything to do, but you know the way they lived when they walked away from that church.
Right.
Hmm? You know the way they were with your mom. You know the way they, come on.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't a relationship with God. It was a religion, a tradition. It was things that we were taught to do, but never in our hearts. Yeah. It was always in our heads.
Right.
And I tell people however big you are, but I said about 16 inches from heaven and hell is between your heart and your head.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
You can know everything there is to know about God, or religion, I should say. Because if you knew to God, you'd choose Him and you'd serve Him. But you can know everything that you had about religion and still burn in hell for eternity.
Right.
Knowing all that knowledge about some religion, or you could know Jesus Christ in your heart.
Right.
You with me? Yeah. And serve Him every day. Make a choice to serve Him every day. Joshua said, choose you. It's your choice.
Yeah.
We can't make you come to church.
Yeah.
We can't make you guys out there on YouTube. We can't make you come to church. We can't make you serve the Lord. It's your choice.
Right.
We can't make you read your Bible. We can't make you pray. Nobody can make you do anything. You know how you are. You with me? All we can do is offer stuff. And that's all God can do is offer you salvation. But when you get saved and when you start serving God, there's things you need to do to change. I said there's things you need to do to change. You with me? It ain't just about, oh, I got an experience, but I'm going to still stay the stubborn, rebellious, selfish person that I've always been. I had an encounter with Jesus. No, when you have an encounter with Jesus, you're never the same.
Right.
Everything in your life starts to change.
Yeah.
Your attitude, your love, your anger, everything starts to change in you to where people look and say, what happened to them? They're not the same person anymore. I know something's wrong. You know, Brother Robert? Brother Robert, you know, hi Robert. I know he's watching. He always watches me. But Robert, he was a drug addict and he was sneaky. He would always do drugs and he would think he was. See, the thing is, we think we're sneaky. And we think nobody knows what we're doing. But you know what? Everybody knows what you're doing. Everybody in your family, your wife, your children, they know what you're doing. You're the only one you're lying to is yourself. You're all deceived. I told the men the other night, the scripture says, don't just merely hear the word, so deceiving yourselves, do the word. Don't just come to church and you know what I mean? And because of that, you think you're all good now? He says, do what it says. Robert would take, you know, use drugs and all this, and he would stay home, and his daughter would stay home with him. But she knew. She was sick, and she got to the point where she didn't want to be around her dad no more because she said, my dad's going to overdose and die right in front of me, and I can't. She got sick. Don't you understand sometimes the things you do make your family sick, and you don't even know it? I don't know why my children are always sick. I don't know why my, you know what I mean? Right away, I can see it in my family when people start to get stomach aches or sick or this and that, and the decisions their parents make, and the decisions that, you with me?
Yeah.
That people in their lives make, don't even realize our kids have stomach aches and are hurting and this and that. Don't even realize it's your strife, it's your fighting, it's your anger. They can hear you arguing.
Yeah.
They can, and you don't realize, and then they're sick, and you're, I don't know why they're always sick, because of you.
Yeah.
Because of the decisions you're making, you're affecting everybody else.
Yeah.
It's a spiritual thing, baby. It's not, nobody knows.
Right.
His daughter was sick. She was having anxiety and all this stuff. And you know what? When Robert truly got saved, and he said, man, I don't know if they believe me because I was always sneaky. But he said, I really, for a whole year, I didn't use drugs and this and that. But once he got saved, you with me? Truly saved and accepted Jesus Christ. His daughter came to him one day and says, Dad, because he always thought, well, maybe they think I'm still using because I can't get sick or go to the doctor because they knew I used to use that to get my drugs. And you with me? But his daughter came to him one day and she said, Dad, you know what? I know you're not using drugs no more. And he said, really? How do you know? How do you know that? You know what I mean? And she said, because, Dad, I'm not sick no more. I'm not afraid anymore. I'm not anxious anymore that this is going to happen. So I know in my heart, you really did get saved.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. He made a choice to serve the Lord. And because of it, his daughter was healed.
Amen.
A lot of times we don't understand the choices we make bring sickness on our kids.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
But you can make a choice to serve the Lord. You want to serve the Lord? Your dad and mom and grandparents and everybody else did. Maybe they were religious. Maybe they did play the game and the church thing and all that stuff. But you know they were never saved.
Right.
And maybe, you know what I mean? But if you want to live like that, you can do it. Nobody's. I can't make you do it.
Right.
I can't make you come to church. I can't make you serve the Lord. I can't make, because you could come and say, hey, praise the Lord, Pastor, how are you? I'm thinking you're good.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, man, they're, you know, but then where have they been? They haven't showed up for 3 weeks.
Yeah.
No prayer, nothing like that. And I don't know. I'm just thinking, well, you know, I'm just like your kid. Don't come home for 3 weeks. What are you going to think?
Yeah, that's right.
I can't make you come.
Yeah.
I can't make you. Your mama, you make dinner every night. Your children don't come home. You start to wonder,
yeah.
What in the world? Why aren't they coming home? Maybe it's my cooking. I preach and I tell you the word of God, but maybe it's my cooking. Maybe you don't want to hear what I have to say. Maybe it convicts your heart and you think it's personal between me and you. Yeah. It ain't personal, baby. I don't even know you like that. I wish I did. You with me? I wish your relationship with your pastor was more than just seeing your smiling face on Sunday morning. I wish it was Monday, maybe you'd come by, or Tuesday, maybe you'd give a call and say, hey, just wanted to call, Pastor, say hi.
Yeah,
I'm praying for you, Pastor. I wish it was like that, but it's not.
Right.
It's your choice, though. Joshua challenged God's people to choose the Lord this day, he said. Come on, somebody say this day. He challenged them to choose the Lord that day. Obviously, they were people who God had chosen. They were Israelites. God brought them to that place. God has worked in your life. He brought you to this place. He's done many miracles in your life. Obviously, you're God's people. But he's still telling them that day, make a choice. Every day is a choice for you. Every day is a choice for me. You with me? It ain't what happened to me in 1985. It's what's happening today, September what? Or, I mean, what is today? April 17th, 2016. You with me? Well, am I going to serve the Lord today? Am I going to get up and go to church? Am I going to make decisions that honor God? Or am I going to live for myself? Because every day is a choice.
Yeah.
He's obviously telling his people, you need to make your mind up, bro. Sister, who are you going to serve?
Right.
You with me?
Right.
All right, it's going to get good. Amen. They put them seatbelts on. Their seatbelts on your chair. They served the Lord before this day, but they were challenged again to choose to serve God. Or go back to their old gods. That's what he said. Serve me or go back. You with me?
Amen.
They're in a new land. You are in a new relationship. You are in a new place in your life now.
Yeah.
You can't bring your old gods with you.
That's right.
God's a jealous God. We learned that what, last Sunday?
Yeah.
You can't bring your trinkets. You can't bring your santos. You can't bring your dream catchers.
Right.
Come on now. Right. You can't bring your monos and your all your santos and all this. You can't bring them with you. God said you got to leave them over there. Come on now.
Yeah.
Hmm? Amen. You see, choosing to serve the Lord is a daily choice. A choice to again today, amen, deny self, take up my cross, and follow him.
Right.
Every day.
Yep.
Every day.
Amen.
Every day.
Amen.
Deny myself, take up my cross, and follow him. I don't care what you did yesterday. Yesterday might have been a great day for you. You might have been in the mountaintops thanking Jesus, tears running down your face, but today's a new day. And guess what? Monday morning is a new day. You with me? A new day for you to choose God. A new day for you to say, I'm going to serve the Lord, or I'm going to go back to my old ways again.
Right.
Amen? A choice to again today deny self, take up my cross, and follow him. That was Matthew 16:24, if you're interested. Definition of choice is this, and I wrote this down. I like to, because you say, you think you know what a choice is. But it says an act of selecting or making a decision when faced with two or more possibilities. An act or selecting or making a decision when faced with two or more possibilities. Amen? You have a choice every day. Whether you're still going to choose the Lord or you're going to choose your own way. And I put in parentheses, the way you feel, the way you think. Amen? And what you desire.
Right. Yeah.
Deny self has to do with desire. Yeah. What I want.
Yeah.
I want this and I want that. And you know what I mean? I want to go here and I want to do this and I want to do that. And see, the thing about it, he said, remember back to Matthew 16:24, if you want to follow me, deny yourself. I'm not saying we can't have dreams, we can't have hopes and stuff like that, but I'm saying a lot of things in our lives don't have to do with what God wants.
That's right, amen.
You with me?
That's right.
Amen?
Yeah.
I was just thinking of the other night we were eating burritos, and one of the guys we were with said, man, I'm going to pay to go see Kobe's last game. $2,000 a plane ticket. And I'm like, no, just pay your bills and pay your tithes. And I'm like, man, we got dreams. We want to do all this stuff for the flesh.
Yeah.
Yet I'm challenging them, hey, what about God?
Yeah.
And they don't want to hear me.
That's right.
They don't want to hear what I have to say about sacrificing for God.
Right.
They would never even think of paying another man's way to go to the men's retreat.
Yeah.
If they got such, you know, make it rain, baby, make it rain.
Right.
Huh? Make it rain over here, cat. Don't worry about flights going here and flights going there and games and all this other stuff. I mean, see, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And the hard thing about it, the sad thing, is out of the abundance of the heart, your mouth opens up and speaks. You with me? And so you can, that's what I say, just get around somebody, just listen to what they're saying for a while. And you'll see whether they're serving the Lord or not. You'll see whether their desires and their finances are to help with God. You know what? You know what Robert does? What Robert has done in the past? Robert has taken all, he paid for all his kids to go to the men's retreat. That's $120 a kid. You with me? That's putting your money where your mouth is. That's saying, I want to see them saved, but I'm going to pay their way to get in there. You know what I mean? That's putting your money where your mouth is. That's making an investment. And see, that's why sometimes we see somebody like that, and we can't understand how God supernaturally supplies their needs. Why they're given so much, and they get so much. Because we can't understand it, because you think, I got to go work more hours and make more money and do all this carnally, fleshly, making a choice to go do that, versus just being obedient with the little check you get and paying your tithes and giving that little offering in there and saying, Lord, I've been faithful, Lord, now you bless me, Lord. We're thinking what we have to do. Again, you're still in your mind. You're still, but I'm trying to help you. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Trying to help you here, teach you a little bit.
Yeah.
Maybe you'll let me.
Because
it is your choice.
Amen.
Amen?
Yeah.
See, life can be hard as a Christian. Because because you're dealing every day past choices, as an unbeliever. How many got some past choices that you made? You know, I guess we can say you regret. That old man you married and you hooked up with. Because remember, let's go back to mom and dad, okay? You rebelled against mom and dad.
Mm-hmm.
You ran away from home.
Yeah.
you made some choices that for that you thought were right. You thought were good choices. I'm getting out of this place.
Yep.
I didn't know you were going right into hell.
Yep.
Didn't know you were going right into the den of lions. Didn't know you were going to be, people and all this stuff. And then you're like, God, why did you do this? Inmates, I talk to all the time, I can't believe God brought me here and God locked me up and go, no, tonto, you're the one that locked yourself up.
Yeah.
God didn't have nothing to do with it. If anything, it was the mercy of God that you're not dead today of an overdose or somebody shot you to death or whatever. He had to lock you up to save you.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
Amen. But there, our past decisions of, and all this stuff. Listen, the thing is what a man reaps or sows, he will reap.
Yeah.
And the thing is that even in our past, and God does forgive our sins, but listen, you still got those kids.
Yep.
What if you want God to kill them, get rid of them, so your past is all wiped up? Maybe you didn't make choice. Maybe you didn't use contraceptive. Maybe you didn't plan your children. Just had them. We had 5 kids. We served the Lord. We trained them up. But still, I look at my son and I see my son living the life that I was living. And 10 times worse.
Right.
And I said, even sitting here, and I was thinking about it, and the only time I said, that generation of curse has my son. And I'm telling you, I heard some stuff even last night in the very places that I was hanging and doing, fighting and acting stupid in front of, everybody. I said, right there at the very place I used to fight and act stupid. Coincidence? That devil will take your DNA. He'll take your past. He'll use it against you.
Yeah.
He'll use the children that can hurt you the worst.
Right.
He'll use them against you as arrows and as rocks to throw at you. Ha ha ha, look, I got your children.
Yeah.
Generational curses and things we did. I never thought what I did back then was going to affect my children.
Right.
And yet you see them growing up, you see them, and now they're in relationships, and they're, praise God, they're married and this and that. But then there's dealing with marital problems in their life.
Yeah,
me and my wife married 30 years, praise God, and it's better and this and that. But you know what? Even last night, we kind of got into it a little bit because of our kids is what they were doing. And sometimes it's just that we get angry at them and we take it out on each other.
Yeah, amen.
And they're still affecting us.
Yeah.
So it never goes away.
Yeah.
Whatever a man sows, that shall he also reap.
Yeah.
And I said it in my testimony on God's Treasure Chest. For those of you watching by YouTube, a new channel called God's Treasure Chest, check it out. It's a testimonial channel. I know you'll like it and share it with people. But on that, I said, I said, the Bible says that if a man lives by the sword, he'll die by that sword.
Yeah.
And I said, when I stabbed a man and when I cut a man when I was 16 years old, I cut him all on the top of his head when we were fighting and I was hitting him with a knife. And that when I got shot all in the same places. I got marks. I got 10 times of what he got. And God reminded me, son, whoever lives by the sword will die by that sword. And son, what you received was only what you sowed years ago. 10 times as much. And I still have I'm sure he has the scars on his body, but I have the scars inside and outside and everywhere, and I live with it every day. The choice that I made to gangbang, the choice I made to carry a gun, to shoot at people, them choices I made, And this is important that you know this and that you tell your children, you can do it. But the choices you make today will haunt you tomorrow.
Right.
They'll come back and then you'll be mad at God for the decisions that you made. You made those decisions and you get mad at God and you get mad at God's people because of the decisions you made. You even get mad at your pastors for preaching you the word or telling you, come on now, you can't do it. You get mad at us for decisions you made.
Right.
And you get offended, and we preach to you. And I've had people walk out of my church Because sin that they were in,
yeah.
Not what I was doing, what they were doing.
Right. Yeah.
But the way you receive it, because when you're walking with God and you're walking right, you receive the word. Man, it's good. And it's like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? It's awesome, man. Praise God. I receive, even if it's a rebuke, you'll receive it with gladness,
yeah.
And say, thank you, Lord, for my pastors.
Amen.
But when it, you're living wrong and your heart is wrong and you're bitter and angry because of things happening in your life, you come in here with an attitude,
yep. Yeah.
And you receive things totally different.
Yeah.
Things I would have said weeks or months or years ago, you would have ate it up and loved it, and today you despise it. And you say, I think I need to find another church, man.
Right.
I don't know about this anymore. It seems like all I do is come in and he tells me this and tells me that. And could it be your heart?
Yeah.
Could it be your heart that's wrong this morning?
Yep.
Could it be you made some decisions and you're taking it out on me?
Yeah.
What movie was that on? On Three Amigos? El Vapo was all mad at his friend. Could it be that you're mad and you're taking it out on me, El Vapo?
Huh?
It's just getting good.
Man.
Oh, Lord. I said, see, life can be hard as a Christian because you're dealing every day with past choices as an unbeliever. You're dealing with people, saved and unsaved.
Right. Yeah.
You with me? You're dealing with people every day, even in the church. You're dealing out there, but you won't yell at them. You'll come and take it out on people in the church.
Yeah, amen.
Come on now.
Amen.
You'll take it out on you. You with me?
Yeah. Yeah.
You're dealing with people, and anytime you're dealing with people, you know what I mean? Like the pastor said, he said, man, I would have the perfect church if it wasn't for the people. It's like the guy stranded on the desert island, man. And he went and made it, you know what I mean? Nothing there, no one there, but he made his hut. You know, he made, I don't know if you've seen Alone or what is that, Naked and Afraid, and all, they make shelters and all this stuff. He made him a shelter for himself, you know, so he could stay out of the elements, the rain and all that. And then he said, you know what, I need to make a church so I can worship on Sundays, you know? So he made him a church, and on Sundays he would go in and worship the Lord and stuff, all alone by himself. And you know, after many years he gets rescued. And they come, they find him, they're interviewing him, they're doing all this stuff. And he starts showing them, come on, I'll show you my house over here. And over here is my church. And they, well, what is that other building over there? He said, oh, that's the church I used to go to. I wonder who the problem was in that church. If it was the pastor or the congregation, I don't know. You're dealing every day with people saved and unsaved. You're dealing with yourself.
Amen.
That's the biggest problem right there.
Right.
Flesh, lust, anger,
yep.
Greed,
yep.
Selfishness.
Yep. Yep.
Oh, we're a trip.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah,
we're a trip. If you only understood you, and you're trying to change your wife and your kids or your husband, and you don't even understand you. Emotions, PMS, it's a man thing. Power, money, and sex. It'll take every man. Come on now. You're dealing with you.
Yeah,
amen. Huh? Your feelings. And what, you know, we're a trip, man. Huh? Which wants its own way. Amen. And your bad choices in relationships, finances, etc., etc., etc. Your bad choices, my bad choices.
Yeah.
See, the thing about me is I'm willing to tell you my bad choices.
Yeah.
You're not.
Right.
You're hiding.
Yeah.
Me.
Yeah.
Yep.
You think nobody's going to, you're like Robert. You think nobody's going to know you're using pills.
Yeah.
You think nobody knows you're going to be misspending your money.
Yeah.
See, because it's not just about the 10% that everybody struggles with. It's about the 90% that you're using your money.
Yeah.
What are you using it on? How are you using
it?
Yeah. What are you spending it on? What are you doing? See, God looks at the stewardship, not only if you paid your tithes, he checks out your business. He checks out your, come on now.
Yeah. Yeah.
He wants to see in your personal life over there, and he wants to change you.
Yeah.
He wants to help you.
Yeah.
And some people, you know, I mean, even in this church, won't let pastor help them.
Yeah.
They'll sit there as stubborn as a rock, talking about how can you say that I'm not changing. Oh, dear Lord, help us. It's our choice. And it's kind of funny, amen, how all this is God's fault. Amen. Not ours.
Yeah.
Not on our exes.
Yep.
You know, that's God's fault. You know, that's happening. No, you chose that man.
Yeah.
Right.
You chose that woman.
Right.
God didn't go there and make you have sex and do all this and do your maranadas. God didn't make you do that. You made a choice.
That's right.
We were sneaky. We were hiding. We were running away. We were doing these things that we look now at our kids and like, oh my God, Pastor, pray for me.
Yep.
You forgot your past.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You with me?
Yep.
You forgot. And the thing you got to understand, remember, it's spiritual.
Yep.
Not just natural.
Yep.
That we're dealing with.
Yep, that's right.
That devil comes and demons and evil and stuff. And I know that's hard to swallow for some. I know we don't want to talk about spiritual warfare or that there's a devil and demons. I know we want to just feel like it's, you know, just life and our choice. You know what I mean? But there is that part of it too.
Yeah, that's right.
I told you earlier about the girl that got sick because of the decisions her dad was making. Yeah. That wasn't physical. That was spiritual.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
Choices we make, things we make, generational curses.
Yeah.
Remember the story of Juan about the great-grandfather dressing his beater and Dickies and tatted up, all viejito, but with his little wine, and then his son, you know what I mean, all in his Dickies and beater and his beer, and his son in his Dickies and his beater and his beer and his son, till finally it was the one little boy in the hands holding the little boy with his little earrings in and his little bandana on with his little wife beater and his little Dickies and his little wine nose.
That's right, Pastor.
Generational curses.
Yeah. Right.
I don't know if it was you, Juan, who were telling me about the man that were the people that were in jail, grandpa, dad, and son, all in the same prison.
Right.
Generational curses, thinking about, you know, you with me?
Yeah.
That's a spiritual thing.
Yeah, that's right.
This person had cancer, that one's had cancer, mom had cancer, now I'm just waiting on my cancer. That's foolish.
Right.
You've been bought with a price. The blood of Jesus set you free. Don't receive that stuff. Find it. Come on now. That's a generational curse. We don't see, you know what I mean? We don't see things like that. We don't look at things like that. We're trying to help you. Tell you, hey, when you receive Christ, the curse is broken off your family. I can't tell you about your daddy and your grandpa. And you know what I mean? Even our children. We can't make them serve God.
That's right.
It's their choice.
Right.
If they want to go to hell in a flame, what can we do but pray for them and intercede and say, please listen to me.
Yeah.
You can't make people serve God.
Yeah.
It's got to be your choice.
That's right.
You with
yeah.
me? It's got to be your choice. But
that's
the decisions
right.
you make will affect everybody else.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. We do things and then we blame God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And I think about exes is they never go away.
Yep,
unless
right.
they die, they never go away. They're there to
that's
be the
right.
thorn in your flesh.
That's right.
Come on now.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
They never go away,
that's
man.
That's right.
Yeah? You know what I'm talking about.
That's yep. right.
They're right there
yep.
all the time. And it's like decisions we made. We thought
yep.
we were doing right. We thought we were doing good
yep.
for love.
Yep.
Really, yeah. it wasn't love, it was lust.
Yep.
Huh? It was get what you wanted, because love, you know what I mean? Love is committed, love will
that's
last,
right.
love will
that's
stay,
right.
but you ain't going to get beat up and say, I love you.
That's right.
Say, man, you know, yeah. go ahead and beat me and I'll just, no, I wouldn't tell you to do that.
That's
I'd
right.
say,
Amen.
Leave that man, get out of that relationship. Don't necessarily divorce him and give God a chance to work on that person.
That's right. Amen.
But get away from the beating, get away from stuff
Amen.
Like that.
Amen.
You with me? That's not love.
That's right.
You
Amen.
With me? Amen?
Amen.
It says, let's see. And it's kind of funny how we blame God, and we say it's God's fault. He's who we blame when all this wrong choices that we made.
Yeah.
All these weeds and all this stuff come back to haunt us.
Yep, that's right.
It's His fault.
That's right.
Huh? You made the choices. That's why it's so important. Pastor said this greatest decision, greatest choice you'll ever make in life is who you choose to live with, who you choose to marry.
Yep, that's right.
You with me? Amen? Amen. I don't want to say live with because that is a choice in itself.
Yeah.
You're choosing to not to do it. My daughter said it, marriage is honorable before God and the marriage bed, undefiled. But whoremongers and fornicators, I will judge, says the Lord.
Right.
That's
right.
A promise, guys.
Right.
You with
Amen.
Me? That's why we encourage our children. We teach our children what marriage is and how. You with me? Do it the right way, son.
Yeah.
Do it the right way. Don't shackle. Don't. And if you're doing, you know, listen to what I'm saying and go to our pastor, man. Hey, pastor, marry us, man, because I don't want to live in sin. I don't want to live wrong. Right. I want God's blessing on my marriage.
Amen.
And on my children.
Amen.
You with me? Because whatever you do, remember, choices will affect your kids.
Right, amen.
But the most important decision you'll ever make is who you choose to be with.
Right,
it's a
amen.
Choice. I don't care how tempting, I don't care how handsome, how sexy she might be. Every choice, man, matters.
Yeah, that's right.
Because you're not only marrying that or six-pack. You're marrying every generational disease they have in their family.
Yeah.
Hmm? Mm-hmm. You don't even know.
Yeah. Right.
They might have whatever in their family, this and that, and that. You know what I mean? Maybe mental illness.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
That you're saying, well, I'm going to take this on. You don't even say. You just say, I want her. You don't realize that she comes with all kinds of. Or he comes with that crazy grandma and.
Yep.
And the mom that's schizophrenic and all this stuff attacking you and cussing you out in public and all, you're like, oh God, why are you letting this happen? That's me. You chose her.
Yep.
Or dealing with issues like deformation or sickness or stuff that you never even considered. You just, I want her. I want him.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
Or the, you know what I mean? Didn't know that they were married before six times, beat every wife that they had, and now he's beating you, and you're mad at God for it?
Yeah.
When pastor told you, don't marry that man.
Yep.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We blame God. We're a trip. When we get discouraged or angry, amen?
Amen.
We're a trip.
Yep.
We'll throw it all away.
Yep.
Just when we get ticked off, we get angry, when things don't go our way, I don't care if you're my pal, I don't care who you are, I don't care about anybody, forget it all, I quit!
Yeah.
Yeah, but really, see, that's why it's important. One lady came to us, right? She came to us one day and she had been talking to this guy. I told her, do not hook up, don't do anything with this man. You know what I mean? She went against our wish. She came in the office, sat before me and my wife and said, you know, pastor, I just wanted to come in and talk to you. And she's doing, you know, talk to you and just let you know. I said, what, you're engaged? And she said, how did you know? I said, oh, probably the ring on your finger gives it away. And I said, you guys, and they said, well, we just wanted to know what you think. I said, what does it matter what I think? She said, what do you mean? I said, you already made your decision.
Yep.
You already made your choice. It's on your finger.
Yeah.
And so, and so they kind of got upset, you know what I mean? And I didn't want to say, I ain't got nothing to say to you. And so they came to church and they started dating and this and that. And one day he stopped coming and then she came in and without the ring. And she come to church and, you know, pastor, can I talk to you? I said, well, yeah, what do you need? And she said, well, I just wanted you to know that it's over. And I said, well, why? Well, one day we were doing something, he got so angry, he grabbed me and shook me and this and that. And I said, no, you know what, my pastor taught me enough. If he's doing this now, he's going to be doing a lot worse later. She threw his ring at him and told him, I don't want nothing to do with you. And I said, you know, you made a good decision. Yeah. I said, but you could have avoided this if you would have just listened.
Yeah.
I told you that. Yeah. And sometimes you don't know any people until they get angry.
Yeah.
You with me? Yeah. I mean, amen. Praise God. Pastor got Bibles tucked. You know? Amen. Sisters in the women's ministry and all this. But I've seen some sisters get pretty crazy. Oh, yeah. Heavy duty. I'm like, my God. Beelzebub. And, I mean, it's heavy duty. When they get mad. When you get mad and discouraged. Watch this. Jesus said, I'm almost done. Jesus said that there was no one greater than Juanito el Bautista. John the Baptist. He said, yet when hard times and discouragement hit him, he was ready to find another church. He was ready to find another church. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 2 and 3, it says this. John the Baptist, who was in prison, he heard about all the things that the Messiah, Jesus, was doing. So he sent his disciples to ask Jesus, are you the Messiah we've been expecting, or should we keep looking for someone else? Jesus said that John was offended at him. That's what he said. He said that John was offended at him. And see, offenses, it comes from a Greek word, scandalos. Scandalon, which means scandal. Which is actually kind of the trigger on the mouse trap. You with me?
Yeah.
You put the cheese on?
Yeah.
And then you wait for that poor little innocent mouse that I was killing all kinds of little cute little things. And but they use the sticky ones. You know, they're lies. They're like, get me away from her. But it's that they didn't know. They didn't realize. They didn't know because they thought they knew what they were doing.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
And we've all been there.
Yes.
I know what I'm doing. I know it's the right choice. Pastor, I love you.
Yeah.
I said, remember the little girl I tell you about in the kindergarten at Parkview?
Yeah.
Margarita's daughter. And says, you know, why did you give that boy a kiss? He kissed him. And she said, that's wrong. And she's telling her, why did you do that? She said, because I love him. She's kindergarten. But how many know as a parent, you don't even know what love is. And you come to pastor and I talk about, oh, I want to get married. Because I love him. I'm looking at you, man. You don't even know what love is. But what can we do? Tell you no? If we tell you no, you're going to just run from the church. Go get married by the judge. Amen. Jesus said that this man was offended. He said, and tell him. He said, go back and tell John everything you've seen. The dead rose from the grave. He said, the blind see, the lame walk. He said, all these great things. The people were sick, are healed. He said, hungry, are fed. Go tell him. Go back and tell him everything that you've seen me do here this day. And he tells him this as he ends. He said, and tell him, God blesses those. Remember, God don't just bless anyone.
That's right.
Telling sinners and unbelievers and all this stuff, well, God's going to bless you. And if you just do this, God's going to, all things work together. You're telling them stuff that's not even promised to them.
Yeah.
Right.
They've got to get saved before they're going to experience these promises.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yep, that's right.
He said, and tell him, God blesses those who do not turn away or who are not offended. Because
Amen.
Of me.
Amen.
God blesses those who don't turn away from him.
That's right,
okay? Let me give you what I wrote here. I said, see, when God looked, I think it was John, he was talking about John, when he got up, when he got locked up. That's what I meant. When John got locked up and became discouraged, he heard about Jesus' ministry flourishing and he got offended at Jesus, at God. See, it was all good when he was doing the ministry, when he was doing things and God was moving, but then something bad happened to him in his life. Just like God, the bad things happen to you or us. But see, it's then when you're tested. It's not when you're over here at church this morning, amen. It's all good. It's when you leave church and go home. It's when you get that call in the middle of the week that your kid had done something. It's when all this stuff happens and you find out your spouse has been, you know, talking and flirting at work. When it's all this, you know what I mean? When come on now. When pastor challenges you to do something you don't want to do. You with me? You become angry. You become discouraged. You start hearing about other testimonies and God blessed them and God did this and oh, they got money and this, but you didn't get your money. As a matter of fact, you got your lights shut off. And then everything I say, see, just goes right out the window. I thought they said that if I gave, and I went and gave $100 and now my lights are off. See, it's in those tests right there that your faith is challenged. He heard about, see, because he wasn't doing no ministry. He was locked up in a dark place somewhere he didn't think he deserved to be. And he starts hearing about this Jesus' ministry and baptizing and the healings and all this, you know what I mean? And you start getting in your heart, and I'm telling you, it could happen to any of us. You with me? If I let it, I'm telling you, I'd be so discouraged. I'd be so down at things that happen and people. You with me? And over my daughter said, not just 30, but 20 years of ministry, saying, God, where are the people? And why won't they get saved? You with me? Some pastor I heard the other day was talking about churches like ours, and he said, why don't they grow? They need to grow already. And I thought, well, why don't you come and pastor in Pueblo and see how you do? Because we're in a heavy place. We're in a, you know, people, pastors have come to this city, this region, and they said, man, I can feel the oppression. I can sense the greed in the people. The little that they do have, they're not willing to give. And that pastor has a great ministry. It travels all over the world. And he said this out of his mouth, I will never come back to Pueblo, Colorado again because of the greed that's in that city. It wasn't that people didn't give. It wasn't that things happened. You know what I mean? And their ministry didn't get blessed while they were here. He felt something. You with me? And Pueblo is just a different city to pastor in. Many pastors have been whipped and sent away. You with me? And it's just the day in. I was watching one of the pastors, Pastor Glenn, the other day. And he's got like we got on YouTube, you know what I mean? As a matter of fact, they got more commercial, they got more powerful stuff on there because they know the electron, they know how to do all that stuff. And you know what I mean? And I'm looking and I'm seeing and they're showing videos of him up there preaching to his congregation and this and that. And I'm thinking, you know, and I'm thinking in my heart, I'm saying, man, God help him. God bless him. You with me? Because I know when we first started how ambitious and anxious, and you know what I mean? That you are as a pastor. You're going to save all Denver. I'm going to save Pueblo single-handedly. We're going to have a church that blows praise away. And then 20 years later, you look and you have a handful of people who some don't even want to come to church. Some don't even want to be here. You have to pull teeth to get them to pray. You with me in this and that, and I'm telling you, at times that could be so discouraging. It's so easy to throw the towel in and say, you know what, I give up, man. You guys do whatever you want to do, forget it. You with me? But to continue and stir myself up in the faith. Stir myself up and say, God, you called me. God, the devil is a liar. You've ministered to so many people through this church. It's not, I can't even count the many blessings and the things you've done. Man, God, you know what I mean? And I have to build myself up and say, and pray, God, send workers into your harvest field. Send them here to New Hope, God. Send revival, Lord. God, raise up men that are going to just be lined up to go preach and pastor and share their faith all over the world that can care about nothing else, but fear nothing else but God. Women who are, you with me, who are powerful women of God and youth that are coming in, and this whole place filled with nothing but youth and children who are preaching and sharing their faith. You with me? And not see it come to pass. And say, God, is there anybody else up there? Like my daughter said, you know, obviously you're not hearing us. And see, the thing is we have that choice. I have that choice every day. You with me?
Yeah.
To say, I'm gonna continue New Hope Ministries. We're going to go on to 25, 30 years of God tearing. We're going to reach the souls. We're going to do this. Or I can say, you know what? Forget these people. It's not worth it. I'm going to go lay on some beach somewhere. You with me? I'm going to just take it easy. You know what? I look at my wife and I say, but wearing out. Wearing out. And you know what? Some of you would... You just go to another church. I mean, you care less. They don't forget her. You know what I mean? All ridden with arthritis and all burned out and all upset and all this. Care less, man. There's a pastor's wife out there somewhere else. Right. We can look at that and say, you know what, man? It's not worth it. Huh? It's not worth our kids coming against us. It's not worth it. It's not worth the hardship. It's not worth. One day I sat and talked to my mom, and she was telling me, she was saying, you know what, son, I'm just resting, and I'm not stressing on all these families, and this and that, and I'm thinking, she's ministering to me. I said, because there was a place not long ago where I was feeling it. I didn't tell anybody, I didn't tell my wife. I said, my heart was hurting, and I was feeling weird, and I thought, whoa, God, what is this? What's happening to me? I knew it was something inside my heart, and I'm thinking, God, I'm not, my wife, are you okay? I'm fine. I'm fine. I just dealt with it myself. I bought me my little aspirins. I said, God, if it's all, what is it, God? And I'm sitting there talking to you, and I'm saying, I'm carrying this load of these people who really don't care.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting here today, and I'm saying, God, I know the word you gave me, God says, son. I said, this message is for you.
Amen.
Amen. It's not for you. For me, he said, you've become, you start blaming me. You, and believe me when I tell you, you know, I mean, even yesterday, I'm thinking, even of our pastors and everybody, I think even people don't care about me. They can care less about New Hope Ministries of Pueblo. They can care less. These guys don't care about me. They care less. They just want what they want. My kids can care less. My son could care less. You with me?
Yeah.
And I'm starting to say this, and I'm starting to feel this, and I'm starting to, you know what I mean? And this morning when I was sitting there and God said, son, I said, that's a powerful message this morning. He said, yes, son, that's for you.
Amen.
He said, blessed are those who don't turn away from me. Don't turn away because of me. Blessed are those who are not offended in me. John the Baptist was the greatest man, Jesus said, that lived up until that time. There's no one greater, and yet he's saying, are you it? Or should we look for another? You with me?
Right.
Is this church it? Is this really where God brought us? Could pastor say some stuff? I don't know. It's just easier to walk away and not deal with you. It's easy.
Right.
I can't throw my kids out. I can't walk away from my kids. As bad as my son might be, I can't walk away from him. And just say, and believe me, brother, last night, I felt like tearing some people up. I felt like going where he was, and this is my ex-son-in-law was, and beating the crap out of all of them. I was so mad and so upset and so angry. And they haven't seen that part of me.
Yeah.
You with me? And I have to hold this stuff in. I'm a pastor. I can't feel like this. You with me? They were coming against him. And I said, I'll be right there. I'll go down there. I felt like getting in my truck and driving down there and saying, beating the fire out of my son and that other guy. I said, you guys want to see what I'm about? You want to see a punk? Hmm? And so that's not the Spirit of God. That's not God. That's not the Holy Ghost. But I wanted to. And every day you have a choice, because there's things that are going to come against your life that you want to react in a certain way. And I know the reason me and my wife argued was because I know she's so upset with her own son. And she don't know how to get it out, and I don't know how to get it out, you know what I mean? And it's like, you know what I mean? So we start arguing ourselves because of them, because of choices they made.
Yeah.
It affects their parents. I said, yeah, I'm the pastor, the son, you know what I mean, doing all this wrong and living like this and stuff, and that affects me. But the decisions and the choices, listen, I made a choice. It said, choose you this day who you're going to serve. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord.
Amen.
We're going to serve the Lord. I'm not going to react. I want to. I want to so bad. I want to let them know with the truth. Because I got truth. And it's not just Bible truth. I got truth. I got facts. I got things about your life that I can tell them. Not you, their life. You with me? But it's like, you know, it's the spirit of the thing. How are you going to say it? How are you going to react? You know what I mean? Because I'm not too good at that, especially with my son. You with me? I don't have the patience I do with you guys. Because I know he should know better, and he's making some bad choices right now. They're affecting his mother's health. They're affecting me. You with me? And it's like, you know, one day, that's what my daughter said, one day they're going to, 25 years that woman prayed for her children.
Yeah.
You with me? I said, well, we've been praying for many years for them, and maybe they'll get saved one day.
Amen.
Amen. When God locked him up, he went through all this stuff and he was ready to find another church. He almost chose to walk away from God, but he didn't. He made a choice.
Amen.
That day to choose Jesus. How about you today? Or how about me today? Are you offended? Or am I offended at God for bad choices that I made in life? Or that you made in life? You with me? You could be here in church. You could be preaching this message. I added that. This day. And have chosen to go your own way. You with me?
Yeah.
I could choose at any time to do whatever I want. I don't have to be connected with anybody. I choose to be. And when I feel wrong, and when I feel upset, and when I feel hurt, and when I feel left out, and I feel like that stepchild, I choose to stay plugged in. I challenge you today, this day, choose you this day whom you will serve. Will you choose to serve the Lord, the flesh? All hurt, mad, and discouraged? Or will you choose to serve God's way? Love, watch out, to forgive others, choose faith, etc. Will you still choose Jesus?
Amen.
Amen. Stand with me this morning.